Hello friends, welcome to the DLED program of EVS. I am Dr. Romila Soni from Department of Elementary Education, NCERT. Today we are going to talk about assessment techniques in EVS, and today assessment technique is observation. You are going to focus on Unit 10, 10.3.5, and the focus of this session is need for assessment, kind of assessments, observation as an assessment technique, need for assessment, kind of assessments, and observation as an assessment technique. So you are looking at the picture also, how the children are observing on the activity, how the teacher is conducting activities, and also the teacher is observing children, how the children are showing their inquisitiveness, how the children are interested in the activity. So observation is a very important technique which is used for assessing the children's learning. Focus of the session also includes kinds of tools used for assessment, how best we can use observation technique at the primary stage and in the grades from class 1 to 5, what are the advantages and limitations of this technique, and then we are going to conclude this session by recalling what we have learnt in today's session. We are also going to talk about how best we can use observation technique at primary classroom. Because we are going to focus on this technique, because observation is a very important technique, and we are going to conclude this session. Now let's go one by one. Why there is a need for assessment? It can be used in assessing learner's skills, in applying the understanding of a concept or value in EVS in different situations in the classroom and also outside the classroom. An observation is like a photograph. It captures a moment in time. So the wherever you get an opportunity when the children are at the task, doing some activity, you need to observe children, how the children are doing the activity, what the children are learning, is there any gap? So it's like a clicking of a photograph and it captures the moment in the time. And then later you can record your observations in a child's portfolio or in an observational notes register. It helps in determining children's attitudes and values. How the children are learning, what is the children's attitude towards how he or she is learning. It can be effectively used to observe classroom interactions. How the children are interacting with each other. That is very, very important. What the children are talking to each other. So observing children helps the teacher to know about children's needs, children's interest, and children's abilities. What is observation technique in reality? And when, how teachers should use observation as a technique for assessing children's learning as well as the children's behavior, in particularly in context with EVS. It means seeing things with a purpose. It is not just that you are looking children and observing children. Looking and observing children, watching children with some purpose. It is a valuable assessment technique. It is a very, very important assessment technique. The more the children observe children with a purpose, the teacher get more experience and teacher starts knowing about the children much better and in depth. And it also helps the teacher to plan her program accordingly. Observation is an indispensable in EVS assessment. You cannot run away without doing observation of children's activity. So that's why we say it is indispensable in EVS assessment. Now, what should be your professional expertise when you are observing children? What are the things you keep in mind? And how observation is helping you as a teacher? Observing is about understanding human beings. That's something you try to do in your everyday life. You try to get to know people. Similarly, when you observe children in the classroom, you know about children's learning and how the children react in a particular situation. So it helps you to know your children better. As an educator and as a teacher of EVS, you bring a great deal to the act of observing. Your knowledge, your particular area of interest and expertise, and your experience. So you need to use these assets. Now, what are these assets? Assets are your knowledge, I'm repeating, your areas of interest and your expertise and your experience. So as a teacher, you need to use these assets to help you learn about children. So the more you use your knowledge, your area of expertise and your experiences, the better you know about children. What should be observed? Now, observing is a skill which you learn by practice and gradually it becomes an art. But then what should be observed? Generally, teachers ask, what should I observe when I am watching the children? Well, as a teacher, you need to observe children's work habits, attitudes towards environment, how they are using the environment, how they are exploring the environment, how and what they are observing in the environment, and how they are reacting and manipulating with the material. Watch them closely. And observation will help you to work independently as well as in group. You know, as children work in group and as children work in small group, as individually in a large group, and when they play with manipulatives and with objects. Problem solving abilities get very clear and children get a master in their problem solving abilities when they work with the material. So as a teacher, you need to observe how the children are solving their problems and how they're exploring the materials and the immediate surroundings in the environment, and how the children are responding to the diversity in the classroom, and how they're talking to their friends, to their peers. And another very important area when the teacher observes the children is how the children construct ideas when they are in small group, and how they construct and develop ideas when they are talking about and when they are doing a brainstorming of any particular topic or any idea or a concept, and how they are understanding that particular concept. So this, as a teacher, you need to observe and record. Then another very, very important thing, as a teacher, you need to see what kind of questions the children ask you, and are they asking questions to you? And if they are asking, what kind of a questions the children are asking? And as a teacher, you need to listen to the children very, very carefully. One thing is listening carefully, another is responding to each and every child's queries. Observing over time. It's not that as a teacher, you observe one time and it's over. No. You need to observe children over time and continuously and in different situations. For example, study their work, such as their projects on plants, their projects on seeds, their projects on animals, their projects on food, constructions. How do they construct their discussions and how do they construct their ideas? What kind of drawings they are depicting when they are talking about any project? How they write, what they write, how they express in their writings about the projects, about the concepts, journal writing. That is another area of observation. What expressions they jot down or they put down in the journals. Talking with their family members. How do they generally talk with their family members? Now you, as a teacher, you must be thinking, how do I know what they talk with the family members? During the parent-teachers meeting and when the parents come to drop their children, what kind of a relationship they have with their parents and with their family members? What do they generally talk with their family members? So, subconsciously, indirectly, you need to observe what and how they talk with their family members. Know the special interest of each and every child of your classroom. This will give weightage to your observations records. Watch children and observe children in different and varied situations. For example, social settings, time of the day. Many times it happens that children has mood swings because of the time of the day. So what was the time of the day when you observed any particular child in any particular activity? Individual preferences. So child has some individual preferences for some specific activity. Degree of choice. Whether this area is, I chose this or not. Level of competence. Where the child is. So you have to keep all these things in your mind when you're observing children in different situations and recording the observations in your observation register. And keep track of what you observe. It's not that we keep on saying that observe over time. Do not forget, do not say that, yes, I have observed this child. Maine is bacche ko dekha hai. No, keep on observing that particular child in different situations and keep track of and remember and note down so that you remember, yes, I have observed this and I have noted down this. Now, when we say that we need to see that how the children observe and explore the immediate environment to develop ideas. For example, kuch bachche bahar jaate hain nature walk ke duran and they just come back to the classroom and they do not have any ideas to further strengthen their project. So you need to see how children are observing and exploring environment and when they are coming back to the classroom, are they constructing their ideas and doing some extension to their activities? Then plan age appropriate activities with appropriate tools which help children to investigate and discover. This is the teacher's role. And plan activities for pair work and encourage interactions between the children and develop work habits. So if you plan in this way, only then the children will be able to do work and it makes your observation as an assessment smooth. Kinds of assessment. Now, what are the kinds of assessment? There are three kinds of assessment. One, assessment for learning. That is called formative assessment. Formative assessment, jisko hum bolte hain, aap throughout the year karte rehte ho. Means, bachche kaise seekh rahe hain, jo aap padha rahe ho, jo aap sikha rahe ho, how the children are learning. Kya bachche seekh rahe hain? Kya bachchon ko kuch problem hai? Agar hai, to aap usko throughout the year jab aap activities dete ho, to aap apne program aur apne activities mein changes kar sakte ho. There is a scope for modifications during assessment for learning. For example, it is also called diagnostic. For example, aapne kuch observe kiya, aapne bachon se aapne koi plants pe experiment karaya, ya water pe experiment karaya, ya aur koi activity karai. Uske baad aapne ek abstract worksheet di. Worksheet will help you to know how much your child has learned and where your child has reached. Kehne ka matlab hai, ye learning outcomes se match ho raha hai ki nahi ho raha hai. Kya jo maine sikhaya, wo bachcha seekh raha hai. Aur agar aapko lagta hai, worksheet dene ke duran, कि बच्चा नहीं सीख पा रहा या बच्चा ने वो एक्टिविटी नहीं कर पा रहा वर्कशीट में, देन यू हैव सम इंटरवेंशन प्लान, जो आपने एक्शन प्लान बनाया है वो इंटरवेंशन स्ट्रैटेजीज आप इंक्लूड करते हो. सो असेसमेंट फॉर लर्निंग, फॉर्मेटिव असेसमेंट, आपको एज अ टीचर ये स्कोप देता है कि आप अपनी एक्टिविटीज अपने प्रोग्राम में मॉडिफिकेशन कर पाओ और चेंज कर पाओ, जिससे आपको बच्चे को समय रहते एक सपोर्ट मिल जाए और आप समय रहते उसकी स्केफोल्डिंग कर पाओ. असेसमेंट ऑफ लर्निंग, असेसमेंट ऑफ लर्निंग से तात्पर्य है समेटिव असेसमेंट. समेटिव असेसमेंट जो एक सिखाने के बाद आप अंत में देखते हो कि बच्चे ने कितना सीखा. समेटिव असेसमेंट कई टीचर्स एक यूनिट के अंत में भी करते हैं, एक टर्म के एंड में भी करते हैं और एक पूरे साल के अंत में भी करते हैं. समेटिव असेसमेंट में कई बार ये गुंजाइश नहीं होती कि आप कुछ मॉडिफिकेशंस कर पाओ, क्योंकि आपने सिखा दिया और अगर आपने समय रहते नहीं करा तो वो दिक्कत हो जाती है कि समेटिव असेसमेंट पे आप वापस नहीं जा सकते. सो इसीलिए असेसमेंट फॉर लर्निंग एक बहुत अच्छा माध्यम है कि जब एक्टिविटी कराते हुए आप देखते रहते हो और अपने आप को क्रॉस चेक करने के लिए आप असेसमेंट ऑफ लर्निंग भी करते हो कि क्या मेरे जो ऑब्जेक्टिव्स थे इस यूनिट के, इस टर्म के, क्या मैं उनको पहुंच पाई. हमेशा बच्चों को करने के बजाय आप अपने आप को भी कर सकते हो, क्या एज ए टीचर मैं ये सब बच्चों को सिखा पाई. सो इट मेक्स द लर्निंग मच ईजियर व्हेन यू आल्सो रिफ्लेक्ट ऑन योर टीचिंग स्ट्रैटेजीज. देन द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट इज असेसमेंट एज लर्निंग, जिसकी आज के टाइम पर बहुत बात होती है, सेल्फ असेसमेंट एंड पीयर असेसमेंट. कोई भी एक्टिविटी, प्रोजेक्ट, कॉन्सेप्ट को कराने के बाद आप बच्चे को एनकरेज करते हो, आपने इससे क्या सीखा. सेल्फ असेसमेंट, बच्चा खुद का अपना असेसमेंट करता है और अपने दोस्तों का भी असेसमेंट करता है, तुमने इससे क्या सीखा, मैंने इससे क्या सीखा. तो जब आप एक रिफ्लेक्शन की तरह इसको यूज करते हो, अच्छा अब हमने पूरे हफ्ते पेड़ पौधों पर बातचीत करी तो हमने पेड़ पौधों पर क्या क्या सीखा, तो आपस में एक दूसरे से बात करना और आपस में पूछना कि मैंने इससे क्या सीखा, क्या मुझे तरह तरह के पेड़ पौधों के बारे में जानकारी हो गई, क्या मुझे फलों के नाम आ गए. तो असेसमेंट एज लर्निंग हेल्प द चाइल्ड टू रिफ्लेक्ट वंस ओन लर्निंग एंड दिस इज वेरी पॉपुलर एंड इट मेक्स द चाइल्ड कॉन्फिडेंट ऑल्सो. नाउ लेट्स नो अबाउट ऑब्जर्वेशन प्रोसीजर्स. नाउ दीज आर द ऑब्जर्वेशन प्रोसीजर्स. यू कैन डेवलप चार्ट्स, यू कैन डेवलप रेटिंग स्केल, यू कैन डेवलप चेकलिस्ट, यू कैन डेवलप नैरेटिव डिस्क्रिप्शंस. असेसमेंट एज टेक्निक विच इज ऑब्जर्वेशन. सो वॉचिंग चिल्ड्रन एट टास्क or when the children are doing activity, listening to children when engaged in activity and discussing or interacting with each other, recording their ideas, thoughts and discussions. Observation help teacher to know how children are progressing. For example, if you'll see in this picture, there is an insect in the jar, which we say teaching through collections, and look at the child, how the child is looking at the insect in the jar. So the teacher can see that there is a curiosity, there is an inquisitiveness in the child. How the children are working with the worksheets, how they are expressing on the worksheet. Kinds of tools for assessment. As a teacher, you need to prepare observation schedule for assessing children. As a teacher, you need to prepare rating scale for assessing children. You need to develop checklist as an assessing tool. One of the very important and interesting tool is also picture reading, which you can use to assess observation skill of the children, how the children are looking at the picture, poster, and what kind of a questions they are asking. As a teacher, you need to prepare observation schedule. You can create an observation register, and few pages could be assigned to each child of your classroom. You need to maintain detailed observation record for each child. Now, what are the things you need to focus when you are writing down a detailed observation record? Children's engagement at work, any activity, whether the children are able to work and whether the children are working in team or a small group, independent work, is the child is able to do the work or the activity independently, attitude towards peer group, resource use and management. Are the children using any resources and any material, and how the children are managing the resources? Another important thing is respect for all, dignity for labor. Many times a child is say, no, I will not do this. I will not clean the ground. I will not throw this. I will not do this. So dignity for labor, each work is important. Passion for learning, applying knowledge in different settings, recommendations and follow-up and feedback. Now, what is this rating scale? Let's know about this rating scale. A rating scale is a tool which is used for assessing performance of task, skill levels and procedures, processes, qualities and quantities, and end products such as report, drawings, activities, performance, etc. Rating scales are used for judging at defined level within a stated range. Rating scales are similar to checklist, except that they indicate the degree of accomplishment rather than just yes or no. For example, in the checklist, we just have two columns. For example, is the indoor space is adequate? So you just have to write down yes or no. Whereas in the rating scale, there are stated range, adequate, not adequate, need action. Whereas in the checklist, there is simple yes or no. Now, what is this checklist? A checklist is a tool for identifying the presence or absence of conceptual knowledge, skills or behavior. Checklists are used for identifying whether key tasks in a procedure, process or activity have been completed. See, this is one example of a rating scale. So N is no, P is partial and C is competent. So it is in a defined state and there are three levels. So days of the week, if a particular child can do, yes, partially. So it is written P. So if the child is not able to do, one can write no. So it is on three level, no, partial and competent. Another is way of recording the observation is writing down your observations on index cards. You can see in a box there are index card for each child. So the flags are coming out, that is the name written on each index card. On each index card you can write about each child observation. Observation, how the child is learning, how the child is progressing. So that flag will help you as a teacher to understand at a glance where the child is in his or her learning. So this is a quick method of recording your observations. How can we use the observation in the primary classes? As we say that observation is one of the most important tool of assessment to collect qualitative information about child's behavior, such as personal social qualities, values, life skills, and dispositions. Now, most important thing is guidelines for effective observation. As a teacher, you need to know, what do I want to find out? When and where should I observe? How do I record what I observe? How do I organize the information I collect? When you observe, you slow down, listen more carefully to children, and pause to reflect before stepping in to provide help or directions to your children. Observation will help you to know and write what you have observed and what you might do. It improves the teaching-learning practices, teachers observing teachers as a form of professional development, sharing instructional techniques. Advantages of observations. As a teacher, you can know about the children's personality. You can use observation to assess individuals and groups. Observation provides you very authentic information. Child's information can be collected informally as well as formally. Assessment becomes easy. Observation helps to know the different learning styles of each and every child, and planning becomes easy. You as an observer build relationships with the children. Precautions, but you need to take precautions also. Observation should not be based on only one incident. It should be based on more than one observation and made over of time. As a teacher, you should not be biased when you are observing the children. Recording should be simultaneous, not delayed. To conclude, we can say, use observation to know each child. It helps to know and connect with each child, watch children in varied situation, keep track of what you observe. It will help you to become a skilled observer. So tips for the teacher, respect and appreciate your child, listen and respond to child, ask open-ended questions, provide many opportunities, connect with each child, learn to intervene with children, facilitate children's thinking and learning. So ask yourself before intervening, should I step back and give children the space? Does the children need me to step in and help? If I step in, what should I say or do? Do certain kind of activities. Study, this is a homework for you. Study samples of children's work and explain what children are learning. Role play the use of observations with your fellow teachers. Write a short story about your perception of a child changed because of your observations. So thank you so much, and we'll conclude. And as a teacher, become a good mentor and observe your children. It is truly enlightening. Thank you so much.